Israeli Prime Minister Ehud Olmert said on Monday there won't be an Israeli-Palestinian peace deal before the end of the year because of Jerusalem.
The Prime Minister is deceiving himself if he thinks that it is possible to have an agreement without Jerusalem.
The government of Israel remains committed to the Annapolis process.
Jerusalem is not negotiable.
Israel has used the Annapolis process as a cover for its unilateral imposition of facts on the ground.
Earlier in Washington, Barghouti spoke to the Rio News about the Palestinian perspective.
According to the United Nations resolutions of 1947, the recognition of Israel as a state was based on allowing Palestinians to have a Palestinian state in the same land on 45%. We accepted in 88 as a people a compromise which gives us only 23%, half of what we should have had. This is a great sacrifice. It's a great concession. We accepted that compromise because we want to end this conflict. Now, to come in and say we will give you 11% of fragmented territories is nothing but compromising the compromise. And what I'm trying to say to people is that we've crossed that point. You cannot compromise a compromise, either two-state solution according to 67 borders, even if you don't like it. We also maybe don't like it, but this is a realistic compromise we have to accept. Or we will have to deal with one situation, which is one-state solution. One thing I am sure of, as a Palestinian who wants peace, who struggled for peace, who negotiated for peace, but at the same time I'm sure of one thing, we the Palestinians are resilient people. We will never accept to live as slaves of occupation or apartheid, even if it takes 100 years. It used to be more popular than today. Well, in the best time, they got 44%, not more than 50%. It was only the stupidity of Fatah and not accepting proportional election that led Hamas to having a majority. But I think if we have elections again, neither Fatah nor Hamas will get a majority. There will be a strong presence of a third of our democratic movement, I hope. And we are working to have elections again. And I think Hamas should be allowed to participate. It has a say in the Palestinian scene. It represents a certain amount of people. But definitely, it's not the majority of the Palestinian people. They're not smashing Hamas. They're having agreements with Hamas. They agreed to have ceasefire with Hamas, but they would not have ceasefire with Abbas. That's the reality. They agreed to have exchange of prisoners with Hezbollah, but they would not do that with Palestinians in the West Bank. It sends one message that Israel only understands the language of force. There is another thing that all Israeli leaders who are in power or close to power do and hide at the same time. It's representing a wrong narrative about the reality and practically working against a solution. A narrative like, we left Gaza, but they followed us with missiles. They never left Gaza. Gaza is still under occupation. You cannot say that they left Gaza while they are blocking the only passage between Gaza and Egypt. What do they have to do with these borders? They're blocking the supplies to Gaza from every direction. They're not allowing even fishermen to go inside the sea and fish. They have their planes fly over Gaza around the clock and scan every meter there with missiles in these planes that can shoot anybody. Gaza is still under occupation. That's a myth they have spread. Like the myth they have said about Camp David Accords. I was a critique of Arafat. We were the ones who criticized him so much about so many things. But I must say that it is not true, the story that is prevailing here in Washington, that Palestinians rejected Camp David in 2000. And this way they killed an opportunity. There was no real offer for two-state solution. Barak misled the world about what happened at Camp David. It's a very important movement that was initiated 6 years ago by a number of Palestinian leaders, including myself, but also including Haider Abdeshafi, who used to be the head of our delegation to Madrid. Also a very well-known intellectual, late Dr. Edward Said. These were some of the founders of this movement, and it tried to present to Palestinians a movement that is not, that is against autocracy, against corruption, against one party system that Fatah have nurtured for a long time, but also does not want to take Palestinians in the direction of fundamentalism that Hamas represents. A different approach that, in our opinion, represents the ideas of the silent majority. We believe in nonviolence as an approach. We believe in a Gandhi approach, if you want, an approach that Martin Luther King used, an approach that Nelson Mandela used. We believe that nonviolence is the right way to go. The reality is that there is an overwhelming domination of the Israeli narrative in the media, whether in Europe or in the United States, everywhere. We need to communicate better. We need to do more legwork better. We need to be present better. We need to unify our efforts together more. And I am very hopeful about the younger generation. I spend most of my time with younger people. Anyhow, the Palestinians are a young people. We have 80% of the people are below the age of 33. So I hope that with more younger people who understand the world, who understand how to talk to the world, we will have better way. But this is a message to the press, I want to tell you. It's not fair the way things are with the Palestinians. And I don't want them to take our side, but I want them to be fair when reporting. It is totally unacceptable that if something happens to an Israeli, it will be all over the press. But if something happens to 100 Palestinians, nothing will be heard about. That's not fair. The key point to honesty and fairness is to accept one simple fact, which in my opinion will represent the base of a Palestinian-Israeli solution. And that element is we're all equal human beings, and we are entitled to equal rights and equal duties.